Hi, everybody. This is Daniel Gray. I am the Trailer Park Prophet coming at you live on Blog Talk Radio from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado. This is the Trailer Park Prophet Show, by the way. I think I already said that. Thanks for being here. This is Hump Day with the Prophet. And we got a really good show today. I found some very interesting stories. I mean, we're not going to have enough time to go through all the stuff that I would like to talk about today. So I guess we'll just get right with it. I already had one show put together, and I went to Drudge and I found so many interesting stories that I decided that we're going to do these stories first. You know, I mean, you got to be flexible. And the first story that I found interesting was this one on Drudge. It's talking about a new kind of research that they're developing right now. It's called facial recognition glasses to help stop crime. And this story comes from the San Francisco Bay Area by CBS, local affiliate there. Actually, it's called Channel 5, KPIX. I'm sure some of you out there are familiar with San Francisco. And a late article posted here by Linda Yee says that by now you have probably heard about the Google Glassware wearable computer. Soon in a Mountain View startup will begin selling 3D eyewear with technology so sophisticated it could help crime fighters stop crime before it happens. It's not a new concept. The 2002 movie Minority Report gave us a look into the future when actor Tom Cruise catches and arrests a criminal before he commits the crime. Often, Alan Yang is a University of California, Berkeley researcher and founder of AtHere, the startup developing the glasses. The 3D glasses are a wearable computer where users are wirelessly immersed in their own computer through virtual images. Now, what was that again? The 3D glasses are a wearable computer where the users are wirelessly immersed in their own computer through virtual images. So it'd be like you sitting there with your laptop or whatever you have, and it's streaming live from the internet to your glasses, said Theo Gaggi, senior product manager at AtHere. The glasses will ultimately be used for businesses, for work, or for regular uses for entertainment. One could put on their glasses and instantly see a 3D screen with a daytime calendar of a list of things to do. The smart glasses can assist users looking at their kitchen cupboard, and they will help visualize nutritional needs. Now that's kind of cool. I could use that. Although, I mean, your body should tell you that. You know, mine does. I always keep broccoli and raw spinach in the refrigerator and bananas and apples and oranges. And your body kind of knows what it wants. You know what I mean? Let's see. One of the goals is for use by law enforcement. For example, police wearing the glasses could scan a crowd and possibly locate a suspect or a lost child. The technology could have helped police find the suspects in the Boston Marathon bomber sooner. Although police had images of the suspects, it took longer, took investigators days to identify them. Current facial recognition programs were limited in identifying the low-resolution images of the suspects from surveillance cameras, and this is something that we're going to see in the future. I actually had stock in a company once that actually did this digital surveillance and storage. But Yang said, AtHere has developed a better mousetrap. Even if 60% of the image is corrupted, you know, like a bad video recording. Yang said his company's technology can convert it to a identifiable image. So the software just gets more and more sophisticated, obviously. I just can't imagine how much actual code it takes to be able to digitally analyze and store an individual's face recognition. I imagine it's a lot, but by today's standards it isn't. I don't know. In the optimal scenario, they can actually get an alert when they're patrolling on the streets, and they can prevent something from happening before it even happens. In addition, the program can be used on surveillance cameras on bridges, roads, or buildings to help find missing or kidnapped people. You know, and missing, also they forgot to mention in there, wanted. Wanted. How do you feel about that? I mean, if it was used in a correct manner, I'm all for it. You know, if somebody has a bench warrant, then yeah, fine. Or they escaped from prison, a fugitive, yes. I like this idea of using this technology to find people. But if it's for something like a misdemeanor, or if somebody is a suspect, all I'm saying is if they use this technology, there's got to be a court order. That's all. That's my opinion. And it says the 3D glasses will be available next month. The cost, quite reasonable, $350 for a model that connects to smartphones and $850 for a standalone version. Standalone version. Oh my God. So this is the future, and you know that everyone's going to want this. Or not everyone. I don't mean to exaggerate to make my point, but a lot of people are going to want this technology. And I have to admit, I saw this coming a long time ago. I looked for the day when you could look through your glasses and see a movie, or say your husband and wife, or your, you know, two lesbians or two gay guys could sit and watch different movies at the same time and be together. And I always thought there'd be a technology to allow for that. And I knew it could be either glasses or somehow they can layer stuff on the screen. But I see a day when that's going to happen, where we have more access to more diverse forms of programming, and on different levels, and all of that kind of stuff. So as far as catching the bad guys, I really like it. But if it becomes more and more futuristic, like George Orwell and Ayn Rand, then of course I don't like it. And I guess the bottom line too is if this technology's out there, you can imagine that some police forces and government agencies are going to misuse it. With any good, there's always going to be bad. Let's see. Report 4 in 10 government security breaches go undetected. Oh, man. And there's more stories about that on the internet about how Obamacare that is really easy to hack into, and they're pulling off a bunch of people's, or pulling out a bunch of people's private personal information out of the Obamacare website. I mean, every day there's two or three stories out there on the internet that say that the Obamacare website is nothing but a abomination, pun intended. And it says here in this story too, and this is in Drudge Report, nearly every agency hacked. Every agency in the federal government has been hacked. And I mean, some of this could be one-off. And I guess the real, well, let's see here. We might look into this. Because I mean, this is really a big deal, but we have to make sure that this author isn't necessarily exaggerating to make their point. Now, this does come from the Washington Free Beacon, And their headline reads, 4 in 10 government security breaches go undetected. It's the Department of Homeland Security, Department of Justice, Department of Defense, the EPA, NASA, Energy, State routinely hacked. That's the subtitle. This article is written by Elizabeth Harrington. She actually published this today at 2:37 p.m. God, how fresh is that? A new report by Senator Tom Coburn, Republican from Oklahoma, details widespread cybersecurity breaches in the federal government despite billions in spending to secure the nation's most sensitive information. The report released on Tuesday found that approximately 40% of breaches go undetected and highlighted serious vulnerabilities in the government efforts to protect its own civilian computers and networks. Quote, in the past few years, we have seen significant breaches in cybersecurity, which could affect critical U.S. infrastructure. The report said data on the nation's weakest dams, including those which could kill Americans if they failed, were stolen by malicious intruder nuclear plants. Confidential cybersecurity plans have been left unprotected. Blueprints for technology undergirding the New York Stock Exchange were exposed to hackers. So, I mean, if they knew about the undergirding of the New York Stock Exchange, that's mean they were planning to set off a bomb. And I remember that report, too. It goes on to say that nearly every agency has been attacked. Okay, I think I read that. No, that's just a repeat. I don't need to read that again. In one example, hackers breached the National Emergency Broadcast System in February of 2013 to broadcast zombie attack warnings. Oh, man. In several Midwestern states, civil authorities in your area have reported that the bodies of the dead are rising from the graves and attacking the living, the message said. Do not attempt to approach or apprehend these bodies, as they are considered extremely dangerous. I mean, some people may have taken that seriously. You know, this could have been another one of those deals of what's his name, and the aliens were invading the planet. You know, a lot of people went crazy. You know what I'm talking about, right? Orson Welles. God, what was the name of that famous movie? It was actually on the radio, and it was a skit, and they announced beforehand that it was a skit, it was a play, and the play talked about how the aliens were coming out of the sky, and they did it with actual sound effects, and people really acted like it was really happening, and literally people started jumping out of buildings and doing all kinds of crazy stuff. So people are susceptible to this kind of breach, takeover of a broadcasting system. It says there are just hacks whose details became known to the public, often because the hackers themselves announced their exploits, which is kind of a dumb thing to do. The report said largely invisible to the public and policymakers are over 48,000 other cyber incidences involving government systems which agencies detected and reported to Department of Homeland Security in fiscal year 2012. Even worse, nearly 4 in 10 intrusions into major civilian agencies go undetected, according to the report. And I'll end on this paragraph. It says that the weaknesses in the federal government's own cybersecurity have put it at risk the electrical grid, our financial markets, our emergency response systems, and our citizens' personal information. Coburn, this is Senator Coburn, who is the ranking member of the Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs Committee, said in the statement, quote, while politicians like to propose complex new regulations, massive new programs, and billions in new government spending to improve cybersecurity, they are very basic and critically important precautions that could protect our infrastructure and our citizens' private information that we simply aren't doing. And of course, the problem here is what's been discussed probably for the last 20 years, and that is that one of these hackers can become, in essence, a cyber terrorist and bring down a major public service like water or sewer or electrical or gas or you know, you name it. I mean, if they could jack up, let's say, the shipping organization in this country, if they could get in there and disable several big large companies in their communications and stuff like that, those 18-wheelers wouldn't know where to go. Stuff like that. I mean, some of the most innocent stuff that we rely on in our lives that go unseen as far as their effort and presence and the joy and the actual creature comforts they bring to our lifestyles, if that were taken away from us, which it could very easily be, because every business, every industry, every public service has computers involved in them, and they're a critical actual infrastructure to most of what we do in modern society today, both public and private. So when you try and visualize, well, taking out a segment here and a segment there, an industry here and another industry there, even if only for a temporary time, the causes could be, you know, quite debilitating, you know, because then you're putting the fear into people that what they rely on most today, seamlessly rely on, could be taken from them. You're gonna most likely create some sort of a panic, and then a panic has a ripple effect in society and can lead to other, like, domino kinds of things in our society falling over. I hope that wasn't too much having two metaphors with one in one discussion, but you get the idea. But it looks like our government is totally oblivious, and it kind of gives me another opportunity to say, you know, government, they just can't do anything right. It's like they're psychologically predisposed to being unable to even protect themselves, and that's really what it's about. They can't even protect themselves. They can't even, with all their unlimited funds, and the government, remember, is the biggest actual entity in the world. The United States government is the biggest organization in the world, and they have almost basically unlimited resources. Roughly, they have under $4 trillion to spend every year, and they can't do the most remedial kind of tasks, i.e. protect themselves. It's amazing. And why is that? You know, is it that they don't have the resources? That's not the case. They have plenty of money. I mean, you could say that protecting their information and protecting what their mission is would be job one. So security, to protect that, would be the number one thing on their budget item. But it isn't. Salaries, benefits, vacation, travel time, lobbying, that's higher on their priority list than actual protection of their information and their mission. And that's the difference between government and private. Because if private, if they can't protect themselves and they can't execute their mission, then somebody else will provide that good or service, and then they're out of business. They're dead. They're defunct. It's called creative destruction. But government never suffers the threat of creative destruction. I mean, if they can't get her done or something screwed up, they just say, well, you know, we didn't have enough money. Or they come up with some other mealy mouth kind of explanation for why they couldn't get her done. And one of these days, oh wait, I just did that wrong. One of these days we're going to get more into the psychology of government. I mean, we get into that a little bit Actually, I have a story today in the first program we put together for Hump Day with the Prophet. But I'm just so into these stories. There's a story on Drudge 2. It says here, I don't know. Let's get into this a little bit. You know, these weather stories and climate change and all of that, we have to get into it a little bit. And this comes from Climate Report. And it seems like a very credible website. And they say that there are, this year alone, 4,406 record cold temps. And it shows the map here and where those records actually happened. So there was 4,406 record cold temperatures reported this year so far. Or actually, it's this year. From January through the 2nd of February. 1st of February. So there's been 4,406 record cold temps. That seems like a lot. 1,259 record warm temps. Now see there again, you know, that kind of makes me go, All right, moving on. We can on our own time. 1,073 snowfall records. No, 1,073 snowfall records. Now, that seems... Now, where are those? Let's see if it shows us. No. Yeah, snowfall. Oh, most of that snowfall is around the Great Lakes, down into Illinois, Indiana, Nebraska, down into there. Some of them are in Colorado. Other ones are sprinkled all through hardwood country on the eastern seaboard, you know, like Virginia and D.C. area, Pennsylvania. And that's pretty much it. And where the high temps, of course, look like they're mainly in Las Vegas, Washington State, and Oregon. And let's see, we did that already. Low temperatures, let's see, what was the big thing? Cold temperatures, yeah. Cold. Low temperatures, those are the purple ones. Okay, now the low temperature records, the ones we mentioned, 4,406, most of those are down in the south, all the way to the eastern seaboard of, you know, what are those? That's Alabama, you have North Carolina, South Carolina, and then all the way back to Texas. And really, the cold temperatures mainly were in Alabama and Mississippi. Ay, 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 those feel... Poor people have gotten snowed on a lot this year. I don't know if you've seen the pictures. And what about Hawaii and Alaska? They don't bother to put them in their study. All right, that's just kind of interesting, I thought. Let's see. Women dies with no propane to heat home. That's sad. Oh, the Discovery Channel is planning to have a man jump off of Everest. It's a TV stunt. Now, I don't like this. This kind of stuff, this really bugs me because they're using nature and they're risking this guy's life and the pilot's life to do a stunt to create, what do they call it in television? They want to create a show there so they can sell it. They're creating content. The Discovery Channel is probably desperate to get some viewers so they can sell more advertising for more money because they can demonstrate they have more eyeballs. And so for me, it just seems desperate to do a stunt, a risk life to make money. I don't know. You're never going to stop people from doing this, but it just seems so desperate. But they'll get viewers. A lot of people are going to want to see it. And if it's live, you know for sure a lot of people are going to want to see it. They want to see whether or not somebody can pull off a big stunt. I don't know. Now, this story here, you know, I've been telling you for years now that the Catholic Church is a bunch of dummies. I mean, they want to think that they can get along with socialists, progressives, statists. And because, see, the Catholic Church, which you have the Catholic Church, they're by and large socialist. All right? And yet, they are social conservatives in that they, you know, they believe in the traditional family. And they're against birth control, which is stupid. And, of course, they're against abortion. And what one thing that's always bugged me is the Catholics support the Democratic Party, even though the Democratic Party supports abortion. And the Catholic Church chooses not to support the Republican Party, even though they are against abortion, because they're not socialists. You know, it's a big disconnect there. You understand what I'm saying here? The Catholic Church, over the years, the last 50, 60 years, has supported the Democratic Party, even though the Democratic Party supports abortion. And abortion, remember, is Catholicism's number one issue. So you would think that if abortion and pro-life is their number one issue, that they would support whatever party supported curbing abortion, right? You know, the Republicans. But no, the Catholic Church has historically supported Democrats. And the reason being is because of economic issues, mainly that of increased socialism. The Catholic Church is in bed with increasing more socialism, whether that's the progressive socialists or the Democratic Party or the statists. And it's why I have no respect for the Catholic Church. None. I want to back off of that. I mean, there are some historical reasons to support the Catholic Church, but I mean, as far as how they conduct themselves in state houses and in Congress, through their lobbyists and the representatives, I have no respect for them. I really don't. On the political square of life in the USA, I have no respect for the Catholic Church. None whatsoever. And you would think the Catholics would understand that in the end, the progressive socialists, the statists, the Islamists, the first person they're going to kick in the teeth is the Catholic Church. That's something the Catholic Church can't get through their thick heads. That in the end, the Democratic Party will kick them in the crotch every single chance they get. You know, the Catholic Church is like some dummy who keeps standing behind the mule that kicks him over and over and over again. But yet, the old crazy guy goes and stands behind the mule again and gets kicked. That's the Catholic Church, and that's what progressive socialists are going to do to the Catholic Church forever and ever. And so this story that I'm all wound up about, oh, it's from Breitbart, and let's see, might be, I'm not sure if it's one of their reporters or not. Oh, no, this is an AP story. Vatican City. The Vatican systematically adopted policies that will allow priests to rape and molest tens of thousands of children over decades, a UN Human Rights Committee said Wednesday, urging the Holy See to open its files on pedophiles and bishops who concealed their crimes. What about America's public education system? And like I always say, the USA's public union run one size fits all big box public school monopoly molests more children than the Catholic Church could have molested in, I mean, they just, the public schools have molested more children than the Catholic Church. I mean, by a factor of 10, 1,000. A lot, you know? I mean, just if you look at the sheer numbers. I mean, what we have here in this country is compulsory education where every child has to go to public education. Not every child has to go to public school. So there's numerically a disproportionate amount of opportunities for public school teachers to molest kids. And I'm telling you out there, that's what they're all about. Not all teachers, of course, but there's all kinds of pedophiles in public education. 10 times, 100 times more than priests in churches all across the world. But yet the freaking Catholic Church would be down in the state house in your state lobbying for more money for public education, and yet there's stuff like this where they get kicked in the teeth by the United Nations and by other progressive socialist organizations. But, you know, they're like Charlie Brown, where Lucy picks up the football and Charlie whiffs it and falls on his back. I mean, that's the Catholic Church. It just perfectly explains or allows a metaphor to explain what goes on in the world, and yet they can't figure it out. You're listening to Daniel Gray on the Trailer Park Prophet, broadcasting live on Blog Talk Radio from beautiful downtown Crestone, Colorado. This is Hump Day with the Prophet. Muchas gracias for being here today. It means the world to me. I know you know that. But I feel like I got to tell you again, because, you know, it really is. It's a big deal. Your time is valuable. I understand that. So I try to put on the best show possible every day. And right now we're talking about how the UN is dishing the Catholic Church. Now listen to this. It said, oh, and a devastating report hailed by abuse victims, the UN committee severely criticized the Holy See, oh, we already read that, for its attitudes towards homosexuality, contraception, and abortion, and said it should change its own canon law to ensure children's rights and their access to health care are guaranteed. Now, do you think that the UN committee is going to say the same thing to Islam? Now, Islam, I mean, if you listen to this show, you know that Islam basically sanctions sexual abuse on women and children. And if you don't understand that, you need to Google it or, you know, put your head back in the toilet. Now, the Vatican promptly objected, and its UN ambassador accused the committee of having betrayed the international body's own objections by allowing itself to be swayed by the pro-gay ideologies. He said it appeared that the committee simply hadn't listened when the Holy See outlined all the measures it has taken to protect children. You know, and that's true. You know, after all of the accusations in the late 90s about priests molesting little boys, the Catholic Church did a top-down evaluation of their whole organization, and I mean, they went through and they culled a lot of priests and bishops who were even remotely accused of pedophilia. I mean, the Catholic Church, to their credit, did a lot to clean up their own act. And let's see, it goes on to say that the report, which took the Vatican by surprise in its harsh tone, puts renewed pressure on Pope Francis to move decisively on the abuse front and make good on pledges to create a Vatican commission to study sex abuse. They've already done that and recommend best practices to fight it. Why don't they ask Islam to do that? The commission was announced in December, but few details have been released since then. The committee issued the recommendations after subjecting the Holy See. I don't ever remember Holy See. All right, anyways, enough of that story. Catholic Church, bunch of dummies. All right, where are we? God, 1:35. Time is going fast. But we're going to stick on the Drudge Report because I'm telling you, there's really good stuff here. Oh, Obama dreamer You know, one of the people through the Dream Act that President Obama passed by executive decree. Well, another example, one faces deportation after killing two in a hit-and-run accident. And that's the thing, too, you know, if they actually went through and did the numbers on crime and illegal aliens, they would find that there are a disproportionate amount of actual violent crimes perpetrated by illegal aliens. And the reason being is simply that anyone that'll cross another country's borders illegally is more likely to commit a criminal act. I mean, you don't have to be a rocket surgeon to figure that one out. Let's see. Oh, immigration group unions push to suspend deportations for 8 million. You know, here's another disconnect. And this is something, you know, that kind of makes me have to scratch my head. I can't quite get my mind around it. And I got this from Truth Revolt. Where's my background music? I hope you guys like the background music. Maybe it's already over. I thought it was for 2 hours. Kind of snappy music. I like having the music, you know, kind of eases me. It gives me something else to think about instead of being entertaining and not mispronouncing words. Okay, so this is from the Truth Revolt, TR. Immigration groups union push Obama to suspend deportations for 8 million. It's a broken system except for violent criminals. No more deportations until you help me fix a broken system. See? Oh my God. On Tuesday, the National Day Labor Organizing Network filed a 41-page rulemaking petition with the Department of Homeland Security calling on President Obama to immediately issue an executive order preventing the deportation of some 8 million illegal immigrants. The ADLON stated that it was sound policy and consistent with the president's authority to make a categorical determination to prioritize resources away from the estimated 8 million who would become legal under the current immigration plan being considered by the Senate. So that, I mean, wait now, there's some kind of a disconnect here. Now we're told officially that there's only 12 million illegal aliens in the country. Most of those are from Mexico. Now, this report says that 8 million of them are recognized as illegal immigrants that ought to be deported because of criminal activity. So that just reinforces what I said earlier. The AFL-CIO similarity supports the plan, which doesn't make sense. And I'll tell you why. The reason is, union members do not want immigration reform of the so-called 12 million illegal aliens because that will increase the number of laborers, which decreases the cost of salaries and wages. The membership of the AFL-CIO does not want our country again to allow for 13 million illegal immigrants to get citizenship so they can compete for jobs. Their membership doesn't, but yet the leadership of the AFL-CIO does. Suggesting that Obama suspend deportations, Richard Trumka, one of the Obama's chief supporters, said, quote, "If I were president, I would have said the following. It's a broken system except for violent criminals. No more deportations until they help me fix a broken system. In 2012, in an attempt to woo Latino voters, President Obama deferred deportations for hundreds of thousands of illegal immigrants aged 16 to 30 whose parents took them into the United States as children. That was the DREAM Act. Well, maybe those, okay, I guess that those 8 million, well, I don't know. Okay, we don't really know how many of this 8 million are actually violent criminals, but it should be anyone that has any kind of criminal record, not just violent. What about white-collar crime? Medicaid, Medicare, food stamp fraud? Those people should be deported too. You know, it shouldn't just be violent criminals. It should be for fraud, for crying out loud. I mean, I know you can argue this, but we are. Now let me just put it this way, so you can't argue or take offense. America is one of the countries that people want to immigrate to. I mean, you could say that we are on a lot of people's number one choice. On their list of countries they'd like to actually immigrate to, I imagine that America is on a lot of people's lists. And on many of those lists, America would be number one. And common sense would dictate that if you're in a situation where you have a lot of people that want to immigrate, then that means you have the ability to discriminate on who you allowed to immigrate. Meaning taking the best of the best. And in a post industrial society like the US, we want the ones that are most educated. Those are the ones that are going to make the higher salaries and pay more in taxes. And what our society doesn't need is the uneducated laborers. They're not in demand. All right, in Tuesday, the National Day Labor Organizing Network, never heard of that one before, filed a 41-page rulemaking petition with the Department of Homeland Security, calling on President Obama to immediately issue an executive order preventing the deportation of some 8 million immigrants. Okay, I already read that. Okay, moving on. Sorry about that. It's just one of those things, cupcake. You got to deal with this. Actually is citizen journalism, so we make some ooboos once in a while. Like you don't already know that. Let's see. It says here Republican John Boehner is going to continue pushing for amnesty. And the whole discussion around whether or not this Congress that's going to meet in 2004 will actually pass a immigration reform bill, that's the big issue. And a lot of people around the country are weighing in on whether or not that's ever going to get done. And my hope is it doesn't get done, because I don't trust the Republicans in the House of Representatives. And as you probably know, an immigration reform bill did get passed in the Senate and then shipped over to the House. And so now the House is under pressure to pass their own immigration reform bill, or they could adopt the Senate immigration reform bill, the Democratic immigration reform bill, which they're not going to do, of course. But I don't know what's going to happen. I hope they don't do anything in the House of Representatives and leave it up to the voters in November, because in my mind, the voters are at a point right now, and we're at a point in this country where I think we're actually at a turning point. And the turning point will be decided in this next year's election, and whether or not the Republicans take over the U.S. Senate. And it looks like, from what I'm reading, that the Democrats have already recognized in their internal polling that they're not going to take over the House of Representatives in November. They're pulling resources out of House races, and they're dedicating those resources to the U.S. Senate races, because it looks like the Democrats are very much concerned that they could very well lose the U.S. Senate. Now, they're saying, you know, through people like Paul Krugman and others, that they think they're going to take over the House, but that's all talk, because what you do, of course, is follow the money. And it looks like the Congressional Democratic Committee is pulling those funds out of House races and putting them in the Senate races. So you've got to be careful and watch what they do with their money. But again, the point is, let's see what the people say. And if the people return Republicans to the House to make up a majority, and if the people elect enough Republicans to the U.S. Senate, then we know there's not going to be any immigration reform unless we get what the people want. And the people, in polling I've seen, want the damn fence built, and they want a wall. I mean, they don't want something that some illegal can buy at a Ace Hardware store, you know, like a extension ladder, and get himself over the fence. No, we want a wall, we want a double fence, we want it enforced, we want it, you know, we want our border secured. That, I mean, I've seen polling numbers as high as 60%, 70% in favor of securing our border first before we have any so-called immigration reform. What a bunch of nonsense. Story here that the speakership coup is brewing, that maybe John Boehner may be ousted. You know, there's always going to be that kind of stuff going on, always that kind of grumbling. I mean, that isn't really much of a story, as it is a rather perennial piece, you know what I'm saying? You're going to hear about that kind of stuff. Oh, I want to do this story. I love salacious stories. And this comes from Radar Online. I love this story. By the way, you're listening to Daniel Gray on the Trailer Park Prophet, broadcasting live on Blog Talk Radio from beautiful, gorgeous downtown Crestone, Colorado, where it looks like Mount Crestone is now enveloped in clouds. And it is sunny. It was very sunny today for my walk with Bailey Barker. It was just absolutely gorgeous. But it looks like we're in a weather pattern here in Crestone, Colorado, where we're going to have a chance of snow every day for the rest of the week. I love this story. As Hillary Clinton prepares to run for president in 2016, radaronline.com has uncovered bombshell new information that could torpedo her husband's torpedo her White House dreams. The philandering husband of the former United States Secretary of State, ex-president Bill Clinton, carried on a torrid year-long love affair with British supermodel Elizabeth Hurley behind White House walls. That's the explosive revelation dropped by a man who says he arranged the secret tryst. Actor Tom Sizemore, you know who that is? In a blockbuster exclusive, Radar has unearthed a secret radio audio during which the Hollywood actor, who had his own 3-year sexual liaison with Hurley, recounts how the famously frisky ex-president once sent a plane to fly Hurley to Washington, D.C., where he bedded her in the White House while First Lady Hillary was in the very next room. I mean, you know, I'm sorry if it's rumor, but we gotta have some fun here, man. We spend most of the time here on the Trailer Park Prophet doing, you know, yeoman's work. So, I just love this story. I can't help it. On the tape, allegedly, recorded in January of this year and provided to Radar and the Globe in a joint investigation, the 52-year-old Sizemore boasts to two pals about how he arranged the pair's first rendition. Rendezvous. I don't know what that word is. Let's see. Oh, and there's other, get a load of this, there's other names involved too. And this could add some credence to this story because, you know, either the Globe or this Radar, they could get themselves in a world of trouble if they say something that's not true. They could get sued and lose everything. But according to the Black Hawk Down Star, it all began during a 1998 White House screening of Saving Private Ryan when President Clinton pulled Sizemore aside from the crowd of A-listeners that included Tom Hanks, Matt Damon, Ed Burns, and Dennis Farina. The premiere of the film was 4 years after Hurley was catapulted into limelight after wearing that Verlance dress. Alright, I don't know, whatever. And Sizemore claims that Clinton asked if he wanted to see the Lincoln bedroom, and after shaking his Secret Service detail, the pervy president quickly made his move. Alright, well, anyway. It goes on and on and on. And if you want to read more, you can go to my Facebook page, Daniel Gray. And you can also get there by Trailer Park Prophet if you want to do that and read the whole article. But we better stop. Ah, let's do this. We got to get on to more adult stuff. And here's one more story I want to do from Drudge. And then we're going to move on to some other stuff that we really need to get into. A lot going on today. I don't want to miss any opportunity to bring you up to speed. Alright, let's see here. I got this from the Chicago Tribune. Headline, Emmanuel seeks to borrow $90 million. No, not $90 million. Emmanuel, he is the mayor of Chicago, seeks to borrow $900 million. Alright, now get a load of this. It says that Mayor Rahm Emanuel, I love his name, administration is making preparations to issue up to $900 million in bonds this year to lower some of its borrowing costs, push other debt off into the future, and overall higher costs, cover legal settlements, and pay for construction, building, maintenance, and equipment. At the same time, the administration is making plans to double the city's short-term credit line to $1 billion. So, I mean, we're roughly talking about $2 billion that the administration is making available to Chicago. And we told you this was going to happen. I told you this is going to happen. This is nothing but a bailout. Chicago ought to be able to handle its own finances within its own economy. Thank you very much. The committee recommended giving the administration authority to put together two major bond deals and double the city's line of credit to $1 billion, even as the city carries an outsized debt burden in comparison to most other major cities. Chicago carries a higher debt level for bonds previously issued and is also owes more than nearly all the other major U.S. cities to its pension plans to cover current obligations. And remember, money is fungible, meaning that the money could be advertised as earmarked for one good public cause or another and wind up paying for overpromised public employee retirement and pension benefits. The Tribune's broken bonds highlighted the city's habit both under former Mayor Richard M. Daley and Rob Emanuel of kicking the debt obligation down the road. What? What is this? Hang on.
The ones who inspire you and the ones who take your breath away. At Kroger, you'll find low prices and great ideas to celebrate Valentine's Day with all the ones you love.
Oh, here we go. Excuse me.
Sweet treats to fresh cut flowers.
Well, we might have a video we can listen to on this story. Maybe we'll just... Sorry about the commercial. It just started on its own. Listen to... Okay, listen up.
City's credit is so bad, taxpayers may shell out $20 million in higher interest.
$20 million in higher interest. So, you got to read between the lines here. And what that little video right there told us is that...
It's almost here. That special day set aside just for love. And love...
That not only are they desperate for money, but they're having problems because their credit rating is so low, and that a lot of their operating budget is being absorbed by having to service their debt. So they don't have the money they need to pay for short-term or long-term commitments. I mean, that, you know, what that does is that it basically tells you that they're in worse shape than what this article is capable of or allowed to be very blunt about. But at least we're able to read between the lines, and in this instance read between the verbiage of the video and get a better insight into Chicago. And it's not like this is any news or anything. It just basically substantiates what we've been saying all along about Chicago and Detroit and Philadelphia, that they're bankrupt, that all these democratically run cities are in big financial trouble. And it says on Monday, Scott said the city's plans to issue between $400 million and $450 million in bonds in March, and the rest in the second quarter, between $180 million and $200 million, would be used to refund bonds. A move that could save the money over the long haul. So, I mean, they're borrowing money to pay off past debt. I mean, it's like a double whammy. I mean, there's a multiplier effect to what they're proposing here. It's the old adage, you're throwing more good money after bad money. But the city also would restructure up to $130 million in debt to begin... or better align revenues with obligations, said that would push debt off 10 years further into the future and increase the overall cost. Yeah, I mean, these people are, they're just like what happened in the 80s. People are overextended. And of course, the banks are more than willing to give them more time because of the increase in debt service, the increase in interest. You know, it's like a heroin prostitute addict on the street. She needs her fix, and she's willing to tell her prospective John anything to get that money, including telling the John, oh my God, I need this money for my baby. My baby needs her medicine. Yeah, well, your baby is you. At the same time, the city would take on between $90 million and $100 million in debt to pay off legal settlements made last year. I mean, that's a lot of money. And you wonder, you know, well, how much of a litigious society have we become? And why, you know, think again, you know, you're learning here that the taxpayers are going to have to pay between $90 and $1 million. In debt settlement and legal settlement. So, I mean, the point I'm trying to make here is that we live in a litigious society. People are suing the city of Chicago. And the irony, the hypocrisy, is that the Democratic Party is in bed with the Trial Lawyers Association. And part of the quid pro quo is that the lawyers get to sue the city, and then the politicians get the campaign funds from the lawyers. I mean, it's like a racket. It really is. You know, it's like a criminal enterprise going on in Chicago and Philadelphia and Detroit and Denver and Washington, D.C. I mean, this is the racket. It's like a mafia, only they're wearing suits and have law degrees. At the same time, some of the borrowed money would be used to pay for this so-called automatic menu money program. Now, what the hell is a aldermatic menu money program? Scott also said that the 50 aldermen each get $1.3 million a year to spend at their discretion on local projects like repaving streets, reconstructing sidewalks, or installing new lights. I mean, it doesn't get any more corrupt than this. Actually giving the elected aldermen in Chicago control over $1.3 million to spend in their districts. I never knew things like that were going on. I mean, that's just like the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, where they get a truckload of rice and beans, and they go out into these districts and they set up a little umbrella and they have a little street dance and they have free food, which they call in Greek times bread and circus, and all the people come and get their free bag of rice and beans, and there's music, maybe a little beer, and basically what it is a trap to impress upon the people that they either support the Sandinistas or they don't get food or they don't get services or they, you know, I mean, it can't be any more corrupt than that. Given the individual aldermen money to spend in their districts, it's mind-boggling. Critics say legal cost and menu money projects, whatever the hell that is, should be funded out of annual revenues because they are basically yearly operating costs rather than from money borrowed on long-term basis. No alderman asked Scott for specific details on why the city needed to double its limits on taking out commercial paper, a way to meet financial obligations over the short haul that is akin to a individual putting cost on a credit card. Quote, the commercial paper program allows us to fund capital and equipment needs on an interim basis between bond deals. God, it's even worse than I imagined, Scott said. The program will ensure the city has liquidity for unseen needs such as retroactively salary payments and legal judgments. So, I mean, here, if you read between the lines in this paragraph, you can see it's even worse than we ever imagined, because now we know that their budget forecasters are actually penciling in or including in borrowing more money in out years. That's their fiscal long-term answer to the fiscal woes of Chicago. I mean, really, I don't know if you can get your mind around this, but that's a real profound recognition that this Scott has made, that their city planners are planning on out year future deficits. And remember, cities and states are not allowed to deficit spend, but this is clearly deficit spending. And it says the city still is in talks with the police and fire unions about contracts which expire in mid-2012. If those are settled, the city could end up owing perhaps hundreds of millions of dollars in back pay. I mean, That gives you insight too. I mean, it's like things are so bad in Chicago that not only can they not pay for the firemen today and the firemen of yesteryear, but they're still having to pay for back pay. I mean, it's like the police and firemen they never get fully paid. I mean, we have to continually pay them and pay them and pay them. It says, excuse me, unbelievable. It says these transactions are the largest opportunities for people to make money off the government. And so we want to make sure that everybody's included, Alderman Walter Burnett, the 27th of the 27th District, said. It's a lot of money. It's enough for everybody. Folks should make sure everybody is included. Make sure everybody's included. We got to get more, as many people as possible on the government gravy train. All right, I got to get out of here. I mean, I'll tell you what, there's a lot of stuff on Drudge today. I could spend the whole show here. I didn't mean to spend half of it, but I don't know. There's just a lot of really good. Oh, fatal car crash involving pot triple. Oh, let's do this story. I got several stories about how the pot legalization in Colorado are working, and basically, I guess the biggest story is that so far, it doesn't look that like the state of Colorado is going to have a windfall in tax revenue from pot sales, but I don't think the story is completely, well, I mean, it's too early to tell, I think. But already people are weighing in Colorado and saying that the government in Colorado is not going to get the revenue from marijuana sales that they first thought. And remember, the marijuana sales tax goes to public education, which is rather profound. And I mean, what would you call that? The marijuana tax going to K-12. I mean, doesn't that... It just says something that I don't know really how to put it into words. I mean, what does that say? That marijuana tax is earmarked for public education. I mean, there's a disconnect there somehow. And that's why I don't like earmarking. Everything should go into the general fund. Everything. Because it takes the power, the authority to budget out of the hands of our elected officials. Anyways, this story is from Seattle, Washington, from CBS Seattle. According to a recent study, fatal car crashes involving pot use have tripled in the U.S. Currently, 1 in 9 drivers involved in fatal crashes would test positive for marijuana, said Dr. Guhani Liu, director of the Center for Injury Epidemiology and Prevention at Columbia, and the co-author of the study, told for Health Day News. It says, researchers from Columbia University Mailman School of Public Health garnered data from 6 states, California, Hawaii, Illinois, New Hampshire, Rhode Island, and West Virginia that performed toxicology tests on drivers involved in fatal car accidents. This data uncovered over 23,500 drivers that died within 1 hour of a crash between 1999 and 2010. Lee reported that in the study that alcohol contributed to 40% of traffic fatalities throughout the decade. Researchers found that drugs played an increasing role in fatal traffic accidents. Drug driving accounted for more than 28% of traffic deaths in 2010, with a 16% more than it was in 1999. And at any rate, you know, the bad the bad side or the flip side of the legalization of marijuana is that now law enforcement is focusing their efforts on pot use in vehicular accidents and traffic tickets and all that. So be careful what you wish for. Don't drive stoned,
bro.
Okay, god damn, I gotta get out of here. I'm actually just mesmerized by Drudge today. I try and check a lot of different media outlets, and I try to get a few stories from each side of the political spectrum. Okay, let's do this. This is a story out of... it's not really a story out of anything. I think this comes from Fox, and this is Judge Napolitano, and he addresses why taxation is theft, abortion is murder, and the government is dangerous. So let's give a listen here. This will give me a little break, and I'll be right back. All right, so here we go. We got... Alright, we've got to skip this ad, and then here we go. Judge Napolitano from Fox News.
I'll say this plainly, I've said it before. Taxation is theft. It presumes that the government has a higher claim on our property than we do.
Hi, I'm Nick Gillespie with Reason TV, and today we're very happy to be talking with Judge Andrew Napolitano, the host of the great Fox business show Freedom Watch, as well as the author of the new book, It Is Dangerous to Be Right When Your Government Is Wrong. Judge Andrew Napolitano, thanks for talking to us.
Pleasure to be here, Nick. It's nice to have the opposite role of what you and I normally have. This time you're the inquisitor.
I am not sure which is more terrifying for me, but I can go with it. Here, a short history of some of the books that you've been turning out over the past few years include Constitutional Chaos. Then you have titles like To a Nation of Sheep, or rather A Nation of Sheep, to Dred Scott's Revenge, to your current book, It Is Dangerous to Be Right When Your Government Is Wrong.
Don't forget the Constitution in Exile.
Oh, no, I know that as well as Dred Scott's Revenge. But, I sense in the arc of your titles more militancy. Do you feel that we're on a downward path, irrevocably, towards a loss of freedom and liberty?
I think we're on a downward path. I don't think it's irrevocable. And I have to give full credit for the title of this book to Voltaire, who actually suggested it to me one day. Of course, it's 250 years old, and a famous phrase from him, it is dangerous to be right when the government is wrong. Look, in one respect, women have full rights, and African Americans have full rights. It shouldn't be something we are happy about, but when you consider the historic treatment of African Americans and women, it's about time they have those rights. And as much as I love Jefferson, they didn't have them in that era. In that respect, we are a broader, more expansive, freer society. But with respect to the level of regulation by the government, the areas of human behavior utterly and totally dominated by the federal government, much less a state government, the surveillance state, the welfare state, the warfare state, the regulatory state, the administrative state, we are on a downward spiral, and we are losing liberty with every tick of the clock. And unless we get a game changer in the White House and the Congress or on the courts, this spiral will continue.
One of your chapters has to do with the right to own property.
Yes.
If we go back to the Kelo decision, which was, 2005?
Right.
That was horrible, the Kelo decision, which basically the Supreme Court said, a state jurisdiction or a state political body can take whatever they want from a private property owner, immediately to turn it over to another private property owner, as eminent domain abuse, defined. But that also sparked a counter force against eminent domain abuse. So are we fighting a good fight, in these cases?
We are fighting a good fight. In fact, just 3 days ago, the good people of the state of Mississippi amended the state's constitution to prohibit any state government in Mississippi from doing what the Supreme Court authorized in Kelo. And of course, the Kelo case only got to the Supreme Court because the state of Connecticut did not have such a prohibition. But as much as I love the Fifth Amendment, which which requires that if the government wants life, liberty, or property, it has to engage in due process, which prohibits torture and compelled testimony against oneself. It is the linchpin of big government. Here's why. Jefferson argued, and I believe, that the only moral, valid, lawful exchange of property is one that is truly voluntary. Hamilton wanted at the Constitutional Convention the same powers that the king did, which is the power to take any property, and the king would decide whether or not he owed you anything. They compromised with the Fifth Amendment, which is the government can take what it wants, but it's got to pay you a fair value for it, and the government has to use it for a public use. Jefferson warned that the public use would be whatever the government wanted its friends to have, and that's where we are. And it's because Jefferson's warnings were disregarded that the government can now take anything. So I ask in the book, do we really own anything? Can the government take that infamous leather jacket that you're now wearing? Answer, yes, it can.
I just
hope it pays you the fair market value.
Yeah, I was going to say it's really not worth very much.
Because it's yours, it's worth a fortune.
I was going to say it too. It's like a car, Judge. As soon as I walk out of the store with it, it's 50% social value. Well, let's. You also talk, and I mean, you have a long list, basically, of all of the, all of our basic rights. The right to speech. There's no question that with, in any number of ways, the government at all levels is constantly trying to restrain and curtail our speech, political expression, things like that. By the same token, technologically, it's clear that we're able to express ourselves more freely and more effectively than ever. We saw this with, things like McCain-Feingold. The attempt to use campaign finance laws in order to stop political speech. Forget about what the Supreme Court said in Citizens United. I mean, the fact is that people are now able to express themselves more freely. Do you buy that, and is that enough?
No, I don't buy it.
Okay.
Two FBI agents walk into a library in Bridgeport, Connecticut, and one of them has a self-written search warrant under his arm. I know this sounds like a joke. Two guys walk into a bar, one has a duck under his arm, but it's true. And they serve a self-written, a search warrant, which under the Patriot Act, they wrote for themselves and authorized themselves to the head librarian saying, we want to know what book so-and-so is taking out. And by the way, you can't tell anybody that we were here. The librarian is 86 years old. The FBI agents are in their early 30s. She says, who the hell are you? She hands the search warrant to her 75-year-old assistant. Fast forward 2 years later, they're in court because they talked about it. The latest trend in free speech violations is compelled speech. There's a sub rosa trend amongst prosecutors now to prosecute people for failing to report crimes that they have witnessed. And I will tell you, under the law, you have no obligation to report anything that you see except treason. Only been 7 treason prosecutions in 230 years. The same First Amendment, which prohibits the Congress from infringing free speech, prohibits it from compelling speech. So prosecuting someone for not speaking, and then prosecuting someone for speaking truthfully, I got a search warrant from the FBI, what should I do about it, are egregious violations of the First Amendment.
You were talking about we need to get people in the courts, in the White House, in Congress. I mean, is this something that is going to be solved, or these infringements and incursions on our rights? Is that really going to be solved by politics? Or because isn't politics the problem?
Politics is the problem, Nick. It's a good question. When George W. Bush was elected in 2000, but put aside the manner of his election, I wrote about that and I was critical of the court. And the Republicans took over the Congress. Like a lot of libertarians, I rejoiced because I thought, after these years of Bill Clinton, we'll finally get small government. Instead, we got a government that was less faithful to the Constitution than any government since Abraham Lincoln's years, because there's just a Republican version of big government. So when I say a game changer in the White House or the Congress or the courts, I'm talking about somebody like Ron Paul, someone who is utterly, totally, and without exception, faithful to the values of the primacy of the individual. The government must stay within the confines of the Constitution. So for Ron Paul to return us to that government would require half the Congress agreeing with him and half the Supreme Court agreeing with him. Do I expect that to happen miraculously in the next 13 months? I don't, but it could.
And, I mean, you must take, I think a lot of people who believe in limited government and libertarian ideals, I mean, when you look at the popularity of Ron Paul, who those of us in the movement have been following him for decades, but, I mean, over the past 5 years, he's emerged as you know, one of the great national leaders of the debate, you know, in politics.
I like to think that Ron Paul is Barry Goldwater, and somewhere out there in the next generation is Ronald Reagan. There wasn't a Reagan revolution.
Yeah,
it didn't happen
this.
The way we
so
we
you want
thought it would
to
happen.
Come after Ron Paul and completely subvert everything that he actually stood
no,
for.
No, I want somebody to come after Ron Paul and perfect it.
Yeah.
We thought Reagan would perfect it. We now know he didn't for a variety of reasons. We could talk about it in another forum. But Ron has succeeded in moving into the mainstream debates over issues and institutions. Which are very serious, like the Federal Reserve.
Right.
20 years ago, the establishment didn't want to talk about the Federal Reserve. Now, even Democrats are saying, you know what, we need to know what's going on there.
Right.
And all because of Ron.
And also the Pentagon. I mean, he has really,
yes.
I mean, not since, you know, basically not since Eisenhower warned about a military-industrial complex do we have a guy who's actually, you know, putting that on the agenda.
Correct.
Let's talk about some of the dicier issues, or ones that separate libertarians among themselves. In your book, you talk about the right to own your own body, but then you're also very pro-life. You're anti-abortion.
I am.
So where does the right to own your own body stop, and where does the right to the infant or the fetus or the potential human life begin?
I believe, and it is a question of science, and it is a question of faith, that a fertilized egg is a human being. It is the byproduct of copulation by two human beings. I'm not talking about some scientist in a petri dish now. And it has a full human genome, and I accept that as a definition. Stated differently, it has all the chemical and biological makeup necessary to become human, to become a person as we understand it.
Now that's
a postnatal person.
With
no
fertilized shot. Egg that has been implanted in the uterine wall.
Is it
not just simply a fertilized egg?
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. If we can't draw the line there is no intellectually acceptable place to draw the line other than the convenience of the mother. So when I say you have the right to own your own body, the fetus is not your body. People say it's easy for you to say that because you're not a woman. I am obviously not a woman. But I say it because of my fidelity to some basic libertarian virtues, the primacy of the individual. The individual is greater than the state. The state cannot, without the greatest violation of a moral law, authorize one human being to take the life of another.
Do you support the prosecution of doctors and nurses and medical personnel who perform abortions?
The answer is yes. However, we have not seen that because of the bizarre frequency with which abortion occurs.
What about women who have abortions performed, and you know, let's say the men who drive them there as well? Should they be prosecuted?
Anyone who kills an innocent life, whether it's George W. Bush or somebody in a back alley, should be prosecuted for killing the innocent life. I'm not suggesting George W. Bush in this context with
right.
respect to abortions. I'm talking about other
dumb comparison, Judge. Dumb. All right, now I'm going to cut him off. All right. Why did he have to bring up George Bush? I mean, he could have said George Bush and Barack Obama, but he didn't. So I'm going to boot him from the Trailer Park Profit Show for now. But you can hear this whole 24-minute video. It's on my Facebook page, and if you like what you heard, I would go ahead and listen to it on your own. Really love Judge Napolitano. He has a really brilliant mind, and like I think it was Einstein said, that you can tell somebody understands something complicated if they can explain it simply. And Judge Napolitano can do that, obviously, but he just passed the line as far as, all right, here we go, Alan West, we're on his website again. I was going to listen to that whole video of the judge, but he made me mad, and I decided I wanted to go on and do some other stories. I mean, we have a lot of other stuff to talk about. I like this story. It's from Alan West. posted today. It says just yesterday the House and Senate passed a five-year farm bill in order to provide predictability to our nation's farmers. And if I remember my numbers correctly, the budget that Congress hasn't passed in 5 years and is supposed to pass is a 10-year budget. It's supposed to be a 10-year budget. And granted, it can be changed from year to year, but that is the projection into the future that they're supposed to consider when crafting these budgets. So this tells me that they weren't able to really do their job, and they instead did a five-year farm bill in order to provide predictability, which they're not providing the predictability that a 10-year bill, farm bill would provide. Anyways, of course, the farm bill is really a euphemism, because 75 to 80% of it goes to food stamps and government feeding programs. Why not call it what it is? Well, someone in Washington thinks that enough of you people out there can be fooled by doing this kind of word switcheroo, you know, sleight of hand. Kendrick Ward of watchdog.org calls it, quote, the ultimate in pork barrel politics, and reports that price supports on sugar will continue to force Americans to pay twice what global consumers pay. According to an economist, taxpayers loan just over $1 billion to sugar producers annually, but last year just three firms received the bulk of it, that money. That's cronyism. That's corrupt. And our political acting class doesn't care that you're paying more for their sugar, because they're getting campaign contributions from the sugar companies. Our political acting class is making a calculative political decision. And in this particular calculus, you, the consumer, you, the taxpayer, get screwed. But on other calculations, you, the taxpayer, are a winner. Ward says $8 billion will be trimmed from food stamps. Hallelujah, lottery winners will no longer receive them. I mean, can you imagine? Congress had to actually pass a bill that lottery winners can't receive food stamps. I mean, if you've read any of these forms, they make it really clear, if you're receiving food stamps, that if you have a change in your economic situation, you're to notify the food stamp office. And people don't do that. And it should be of some criminal consequence, because you're basically defrauding the federal government. So the federal government, the state government, are refusing to enforce the spirit of these welfare laws. I know I've read them. And here, and the reason they're doing this now is so that people think that they're actually doing something. Hallelujah. But a work provision for adult eligibility is still optional. See, now this is a big part of this story that this particular piece doesn't go into. And you got to remember, during the welfare reform legislation of the Clinton era, this one little part was pivotal. I mean, it was key. The work provision for adult eligibility is still optional. And what it's the big change under the Clinton administration was that if you're receiving food stamps or Section 8 housing or whatever government program, that you had to be actively seeking work. It had to be quantifiable. I mean, you had to go and make, I'm trying to remember, something like 3 to 5 actual contacts of employers offering employment. And that provision was vacated during the Obama administration. And this was a key provision of the Clinton-era welfare reform era. I mean, this is key. And this article only dedicates like a half of a sentence to it. All right, let's see here. The work provision eligibility is still optional, like I said. Junk food additives, including high fructose corn syrup, will continue to be subsidized. Enough to buy every kid under 18 8 2-liter bottles of soda a year. Wonder what Michelle Obama has to say about that. Now, this is the height of absurdity here. I mean, we've been hearing from the government how bad sugar is, and we've heard from other segments of society how bad corn syrup is, fructose. And then we find out that we're spending our tax dollars to subsidize the sugar and fructose industry. I mean, it's just hypocrisy. It's insanity, you know. But if the lamestream media doesn't report on this, people aren't going to know about it. And a lot of people that went to our one-size-fits-all government schools, I mean, they're not able to process this information. They're not able to think critically. They've actually been turned into mindless zombies, a lot of them. It's kind of a shame. You're listening to the Trailer Park Prophet, broadcasting live from beautiful downtown Crest. Stone on Blog Talk Radio. This is Hump Day with the Prophet. My name is Daniel Gray. I was born in Colorado, in Denver, Colorado. All right, let's see. I want to do more about this story. Oh, and you'll be pleased to know companies like McDonald's and Fruit of the Loom and other giant agricultural companies and trade associations will continue to receive funds from the $200 million per year market access program, which subsidizes ad campaigns. I mean, why should the taxpayers have to pay for this? You know, this is exactly what I've talked about before. Big government loves big business, and big business loves big government. And these kind of, I don't want to go into it too deep. Even those on the left are concerned about the massive wasteful spending, yeah. All right, one more pull quote. Dan Smith, tax and budget advocate for the Progressive U.S. Public Interest Research Group, stated, taxpayer money has even been used to pay for a reality TV show in India to promote cotton. Oh, you know what? Here's something that's kind of funny, too, and that is that we're still producing cotton in the United States, and cotton is subsidized. Because even though places like India and Bangladesh, and I'm trying to think of Brazil, other countries out there are producing cotton at a fraction of the USA's cost to produce cotton. So the US government is subsidizing our United States, our domestic cotton production. It's crazy. Like a bunch of crack whores. All right. Okay, I'm not going to do that story. Oh, let's do this story. In honor of Black History Month, And, you know, I got to apologize. I thought January was Black History Month, and now I know I was wrong. It's February, so I want to apologize. But in honor of Black History Month, I got this from my Black conservative friend in New York. Her name is, her handle, her alias, is Eve Afro City Brown. Now, that's a cool name. And she, again, is a Black conservative female. All right, in 1990, Columbia University graduate and Harvard University law student Barack Obama became the first African-American named president of the Harvard Law Review. I didn't realize he was first. That's a big deal, being first. And see, this is one of the rubs that some out there have in regards to Barack Obama being the first Black to be the editor of the Harvard Law Review, and that is that he never published a paper. It's traditional for the president of the Harvard Law Review to publish an article, and no one can find anything that Barack Obama has published. And the other accusation that's out there, and I know this is kind of seemly, but I got to do it, is that Barack Obama, when he was the president of the Harvard Law Review, actually sexually harassed some of the staff, and they were males. So Barack Obama is accused allegedly of being a gay sexual harasser when he was the president of the Harvard Law Review, and all of that's been covered up. 1994, avowed white supremacist Brian D. La Beckwith is convicted of Medgar Evans' murder more than 30 years after he was shot in the back from an ambush. Well, that's good. I don't think I remember that. Well, maybe I do. All right, 1934. Hank Aaron, baseball home run king born. 1934, Hank Aaron. Interesting. And Hank Aaron, right, he was the first Black professional baseball player. Was it Hank Aaron? No, I forget. All right. Going later into history. Again, we're honoring Black History Month. In 1869, Minnie Cox, first Black postmistress in the U.S. and educator, is born in Lexington, Mississippi. This is interesting. I don't ever remember reading something where the famous people were introduced in the piece from when they were born, but I kind of like it. So Minnie Cox in 1869 was the first Black postmistress, meaning postmistress, postman or whatever. Not postman, you're the postmaster. Oh, okay, that's why. Generally, they call the local postmaster, but here they said postmistress. Okay, it kind of confused me a little. All right, so Minnie Cox was the first postmistress in the U.S., and she was also an educator, is born in Lexington, Mississippi. She probably went to college, too. In 1884, W. Johnson, inventor, patented the egg beater. Huh. And the beat goes on. And the beat goes on. All right, that was in honor of Black History Month. I love this story because it confirms what I've been saying to you for the last almost 3 years now. And by the way, sometime during this month, I'm kind of afraid to look, are celebrating during February here, 2014, 1 year that the Trailer Park Prophet has been on Blog Talk Radio. We're going to celebrate 1 year. I can't believe that we've been on Blog Talk Radio for a year, but we have. And I don't want to make too big of a deal of it, but it is an anniversary. It is a big body of work to actually do 6 hours a week, and maybe I'm trying to beg for compliments. I'm not sure. At any rate, I wanted to mention that today. But anyways, moving on, I got this story here. I just absolutely, positively love this story. I got to set it up for you. This is a group of activist Latinos, and they got together recently in Boston. They had a convention. And of course, if you go to a convention, you're going to have speakers and you're going to have a lot of extramarital sex or you'd be saying, well, you better not be projecting. So, okay, here we go. Where am I here? All right, so this is in this convention, and here's the first poll quote. It says, and I kid you not, I mean, these people are individuals who are of Latin American race. They're brown colored, they're Latinos, and they're employed mostly in government, as close as I can tell. So they get this convention, and at one point in time, this Hispanic leader says, "You old white people, it's your duty to die. You old white people, it's your duty to die." Augustin Sabata Brown Barrett's quote, "Go back to Boston. Go back to Plymouth Rock, pilgrims. Get out. We are the future. You are old and tired. Go on. We have beaten you. Leave like beaten rats. You old white people, it is your duty to die. Through love of having children, we are going to take over." Now, this isn't fiction here, my friends. Hey, I want to listen to background music. I hope you don't mind. Is that too loud? That's not too bad. Oh my God, we don't have a lot of time left. I got so many more stories I want to do for you today. But I want to continue on this story. I think this is really important. It goes on to say in this article, Hispanic leaders speak out. Richard Althori, Los Angeles City Council, quote, "They're afraid we're going to take over the government institutions and other institutions. They're right. We will take them over. We are here to stay. Excelsior, the national newspaper of Mexico, quote, "The American Southwest seems to be slowly returning to the jurisdiction of Mexico without firing a single shot." Now that's rather profound. Professor Jose Angel Gutierrez, University of Texas, quote, "We have an aging white America. They are not making babies. They are dying. The explosion is in our population. I love it. They are shitting in their pants with fear. I love it." Art Torres, chairman of the California Democratic Party, quote, "Remember 187 proposition to deny taxpayer funds for services to non-citizens was the last gasp of white culture in California." I mean, this is a declaration of war, my friends. This is as racist as you can get. If you look at the dictionary definition of racism, it's that one race is better than another. That's textbook definition, just so you know. And obviously, these people feel like they're better than white people. Gloria Molina, Los Angeles County Supervisor, said, quote, "We are politicizing every single one of these new citizens that are becoming citizens of our country. I got to tell you that a lot of people are saying, quote, I'm going to go out there and vote because I want to pay them back. It's a quick pro quo." Marino Abledo, California Coalition of Hispanic Organizations, and California State Secretary of Health, Education, and Welfare under Governor Jerry Brown, also awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom by President Bill Clinton. Quote, "California is going to be a Hispanic state. Anyone who doesn't like it should leave." Jose Piscado Azuña, the Mexican Council General, he's an official, he says that we are practicing La Reconquista in California, meaning the reconquering. I mean, so that guy's putting it in actual war terminology. I mean, his rhetoric is that's war rhetoric there. Reconquering. So by definition, they're recognizing, I don't think they realize this, is that the Spanish conquered this area of California, New Mexico, Arizona, and Colorado. They conquered it first. So now they're saying they're reconquering it. You know, talk about a linguistic misstep. Had they been thinking, they would have not used reconquered, but it's really the truth. I mean, they unrightfully, the Spanish I'm speaking of, unrightfully conquered the territory of California, Colorado, blah, 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 from the Indians. I mean, that's an important distinction that you need to keep in your mind, because this... there's going to be more and more coming up about this reconquering of California without a shot. Trust me. All right, so Professor Ferdinand Guerra, Loyola Marymount University, said we need to avoid a white backlash by using codes understood by Latinos. When I was young, I remember hearing about the immigrants that came through the Ellis Island. They wanted to learn English. They wanted to breathe free. They wanted to become Americans. Now too many immigrants come here with demands. They demand to be taught in their own language. They demand special privileges, affirmative action. They demand ethnic studies that glorify their culture. How can we help? Send copies. Okay. All right, so anyway, I guess that's the basic story right there that I thought was worth sharing. And of course, remember the rhetoric early on in that piece was very racial, very, you know, it shows the pictures of these people and they got their fists up in the air. I mean, that's an act of war and violence. And, you know, they're an audience of Latinos that I'm speaking of with the fists in the air. And they're threatening, you know. I mean, this is the threat of physical action. This is a technique that the radical Latinos have used for many years. I got a story to tell you sometime about when I was on the UNC, the University of Northern Colorado. I was on their student board, and I was on the budget review, and we didn't give the Latino club the amount of money that they wanted, and they actually threatened to kill me. I want to remind you out there that the Republican Party has a official segment, part of the Republican organization, in the Republican tent, as some people say, and they're called the Log Cabin Republicans. And I just want to remind people that the Log Cabin Republicans are proud members of the GOP, who believe Inclusion wins. Log Cabin Republicans is the largest national Republican organization dedicated to representing gays, lesbians, multigendered, all of that. But let me give you the date here. Actually, I want to spend a little time on this. This is important. All right, let's see if I got, where's the history? I want to read the history of the Log Cabin Republicans. Here we go. Log Cabin Republicans is the nation's largest Republican organization dedicated to representing gay and lesbian conservatives and allies. For more than 30 years, we have promoted the fight for equality through our state and local chapters, our full-time office in Washington, D.C., and our federal and state political action committees. And I want everyone to understand that I am very proud of the Log Cabin Republicans, and they're a very honorable group, and they're trying to make change out in the open. And it's a beautiful thing. They're under the Republican tent, and they're trying to make change, and they've been there for 30 years. I mean, God, that's a lot of years. But a lot of people out there don't know about the Log Cabin Republicans because the lamestream media and our education industry is lying to us by omission. Okay, this story, what do we got, 10 minutes left. All right, I got to do this quote from Rose Kennedy, and then we're going to end up with this story from the Super Bowl. All right, here's a quote from Rose Kennedy. Quote, it has been said, time heals all wounds. I do not agree. The wounds remain. In time, the mind, protecting its sanity, covers them with scar tissue, and the pain lessens. But it is never gone. Rose Kennedy. All right, we're going to end up on this story here at the Trailer Park Prophet Show, Hump Day with the Prophet, with Daniel Gray, your host du jour. Again, thanks for being here. Okay, this story comes from We Are the People, 100% Fed Up, Exposed. Here, I'll just start right here. Well, now I better read the headline. Exposed. Coca-Cola's Super Bowl commercial was a stealth push for amnesty by its Muslim CEO. And this is the advertisement that was produced and actually shown during the Super Bowl on Sunday. And it was a Coca-Cola commercial, and it had a... The song they sung was America the Beautiful, and it was sung by various cultures in their native language, I guess is the quick way to actually portray it to you. But it was basically celebrating diversity. And this article here says, flashback to 2013, Coca-Cola's Muslim CEO writes op-ed pushing immigration reform, Huffington Post, Forbes list Coke as top amnesty supporter. I had no idea. I mean, just the... I don't want to, like, overplay this, but the fact that the CEO of Coca-Cola is Muslim is worthy of note. Coca-Cola has been on a major amnesty push for at least a year in hopes that it can obtain cheap labor. Huh? See what I mean? Big government, big business are in bed together, and the people be damned, right? And because its CEO, Muhtar Kent, is a Muslim who has raised in places like Iran and Indonesia, perhaps for even more sinister reasons. Regardless, his push makes it very clear that the Super Bowl ad was 100% political, designed to influence public opinion, propagandizing the people in favor of immigration ahead of coming amnesty battle in Congress. In the military, this is called a PSYOP, psychological operation. Mutar is engaging in the amnesty war, just like Facebook's Mark Zuckerberg is, and I'll be curious to know just how much of his salary and Koch's profits go to Muslim charities that are really fronts for terrorist organizations, as most Muslim charities are. February 28, 2013, editorial in the USA Today by Coca-Cola CEO Mutar Kent, entitled "Immigration Reform Good for Business." He says, "Though I am not an immigrant, I've lived certain aspects of the immigrant experience. I was born in New York City when my father was serving as Turkey's consul general." So, I mean, this guy is a privileged individual. "As he assumed other diplomatic posts, our family lived in Taiwan, Poland, Iran, India, and elsewhere. In 1978, I returned to New York with a British university degree and a birth certificate in my pocket. A newspaper helped wanted ad led me to a job riding Red Route trucks and delivering the beverages of the Coca-Cola company to retail outlets. I immediately fell in love with the company and my birthplace. I chose to make my life in this country, being a U.S. citizen, my birth. I was fortunate to have that choice." So, I mean, here he is being really stern in his effort to build his image as a Muslim American. "I was lucky." But at any rate, it goes into explaining how he's trying to promote this notion of multiculturalism, which is nothing more than what our founding fathers called as fractionalism, and will eventually destroy us. Like Lincoln said, a house divided shall not stand. And it's like Coca-Cola is intentionally trying to help fragment our society and inevitably destroy it. "The concept in America is out of many one. And what Coca-Cola and the multicultural movement are trying to do is make it into out of one many. In one country, many. Multicultural. And as we discussed last week, that's a recipe for fractionalism and eventual disaster. Alright, enough said there. I wish we had more time, but it's time to get out of here. Listen, thanks a lot for being here, everybody. I really appreciate it. We'll see you on Friday for Local Friday. Remember, you're number one, and so is everybody else. Thank you. Thank you for letting me exercise my First Amendment rights. Blog Talk and YouTube. Gotta go.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
Goodbye.